The most important story this week is probably one you've heard the least about.
You don't have to be poor anymore! Jesus is here!
The loudspeaker spoke up and said, Christianity is stupid.
Greetings, fellow worker slaves, podcasting at 128 kilobits from the Fortress of Squalitude, not far from the Redneck Mecca. This is the Atheist in the Trailer Park podcast. I'm your host, Tucker. Professor Fuzznuts is curled up on the couch with Buddha. Ash and Lord Squeakington are in my room doing whatever it is they do. Yes, it's a podcast hosted by a guy and his cats. Get over it. This is a news show episode where I cover stories in the news that are related to things like atheism, secularism, science, or I find just plain interesting. Next episode will be a chapter or two from the Pista Sophia. And it may be late because I think I'm off next week, or not next week, the week after. And if Skullbeard can only record late on Sunday night or whenever, then that's when we'll do it. And so it'll go up on Monday or Tuesday, just depending. Now, work this past week was essentially the same old, sort of. For some reason, they scheduled the bulk of our workload on 2 days in the middle of the week. I got to put in 2 12-hour days, but folks in other departments had to put in a 15 or 16-hour day on Wednesday. Then, they only worked part of Thursday and Friday. Why the fuck this was, I have no clue, and apparently neither does anyone else. It looked, briefly, like my department was going to be able to leave early on Friday, which would have been so, so nice. But no, right at the point when they were about to cut us loose, the meat truck showed up, so we had work to do. I know with me having a week off at the end of this month, I should want all the hours I can get, but it'd be really nice to be able to leave work early once in a while. Or hell, even on time. Instead of having to stay over, you know, half an hour, or 4 fucking hours. Not really any other exciting news, I'm afraid. Democratic Party's potluck is coming up. This week, maybe I'll get to go, maybe I won't, I don't know. I have no idea, because I have such a fucked up work schedule. My big event this weekend was I spent a portion of today attempting to fix the lid on my garbage can, since the city won't empty the cans if the lid is broken, and it's $200 for a replacement can. Or at least it was when I had to replace the can the last time about 10 years ago. Not sure what the cost is up to now, but the cans are basically disposable. The hinge on the plastic lid tends to crack, and there's no way you can get a replacement lid for them. So when the lid breaks off, you have to get a new can. Nice, huh? Part of the hinge is already broken, and the other part has started to crack. I've attempted to fix it using JB Cold Weld in hopes that that will keep everything together for some time to come. I really don't want to have to buy another trash can. I suppose 10 years is a long time for one, but still, you know, it's not something I need to be spending my money on right now. All right, let's get to the news.
Have I helped your unbelief?
Yes, I believe. I believe in death. I believe in disease. I believe in injustice and inhumanity and torture and anger and hate. I believe in murder. I believe in pain. I believe in cruelty and infidelity. I believe in slime and stink and in every crawling, putrid thing, every possible ugliness and corruption, you son of a bitch! I believe! In you.
From churchandstate.org.uk. Trump's attorney general wants God's moral order enforced by government. As the nation lurches closer towards being ruled by a tyrannical dictator with unwavering support from the Republican Party, the American people are ignoring an even greater threat to their waning secular democracy, rule by tyrannical theocrats. The rise of theocrats in powerful positions of authority is particularly disconcerting because not only was America created as a secular nation with a secular constitution, but because the theocrats running the federal government represent a very small minority of the population. And now Trump has given that vicious minority what they elected him to do in the first place. Another radical Christian extremist, William Barr, in a powerful federal government position. J. Beauregard Sessions was a legitimate threat to America's secular government as Trump's attorney general, but his theocratic aspirations paled in comparison to Trump's latest theocratic cabinet member, a conservative Catholic malcontent. Oh, sort of like the late Justice Scalia, who was unlikely to ever defend the U.S. Constitution because it is a secular document. It is noteworthy that Sessions only stated that, according to his mind, the separation of church and state in the Constitution is a concept that is unconstitutional. Okay, that makes no sense whatsoever. However, his replacement ardently believes that God's government is duty-bound to enforce God's law because there is no place for secularism. Yeah, this guy is blaming, you know, the opioid crisis and just about every other ill in America on secular values. Never mind the fact that prayer doesn't cure addiction, whereas science can. This is where we are, and this is a guy to be worried about. Most people seem to forget this. He covered up shit during Iran-Contra until the statute of limitations ran out so that the people who violated the law couldn't be prosecuted, amongst many other things that he's done. And he just recently gave a speech and I think the Value Voters Summit where he went off on all this shit and started, you know, the whole thing about how this is supposed to be a Christian nation. And the fool doesn't understand American history. The First Amendment, which is where we get the whole idea of separation of church and state in the U.S., was heavily promoted by religious leaders, because most Americans at that time were not members of the Church of England. That was one of the reasons why they came to America, and they wanted the separation of church and state because they knew how shitty it was to be one religion and your government a different one. But people don't think that. They only think, well, we'll just make the government Christian, and then suddenly, some point later on, you get somebody in there who has a certain set of beliefs that they want the government to enforce, and people are like, oh my God, I don't share those religious beliefs. Well, too fucking bad. You wanted a Christian country, now you got it. You're just upset that it's the wrong kind of Christian. Trust me, there will never be the right kind of Christian running a Christian country. Because that's the way these things always go.
You know, that really is a nice collection. Must have taken you a long time to hunt down all that history.
From the independent.co.uk, Ancient images of gladiators unearthed at City of Pompeii. Archaeologists have uncovered a well-preserved fresco of two fighting gladiators in the ancient Roman city of Pompeii. It depicts two gladiators in action, one wielding a short sword, the other cowering as blood spurts from wounds all over his body. The defeated soldier is lifting his finger to beg for mercy. Dario Franceschini, Italy's culture minister, said the discovery showed Pompeii was an inexhaustible mine for research and knowledge for archaeologists. The city is undergoing a new phase of excavation, the Great Pompeii Project, funded by the European Union and Italy. It has already unearthed villas decorated with frescoes and mosaics, as well as the remains of human skeletons trapped beneath the rubble. And the pictures of this fresco are incredible. I mean, there's some bits of damage on the fresco, which you'd expect, but it is a gorgeous, gorgeous fresco. Ridley Scott's folks must have seen something like this when they were doing the movie Gladiator, because it looks like it could be a scene from that movie. And those of you who've, you know, like looked at medieval artwork and, you know, noticed that the figures are barely better than stick figures, this looks like it could have been painted by a Da Vinci or a Michelangelo. I mean, it is, you know, that well done. It certainly looks like some of their work. Maybe not quite as good as theirs, but you know, far better than the illustrations in the medieval manuscripts that you often see. Obviously, when Rome fell, there was a loss of artistic ability as well. But yeah, it's gorgeous. It's incredibly well preserved. You know, it being almost 2,000 years old and having been buried for almost 2,000 years, because it was 80 CE, I think, that Pompeii was destroyed, somewhere around there. So it's remarkable that it survived at all, and it's gorgeous. It is, you know, of course, the link will be in the show notes, and it's well worth checking out that image. The article's not very long, so if you don't read it, you don't miss much, but you will miss a lot by not looking at that fresco. It is gorgeous, gorgeous, gorgeous. From Gizmodo.com, ancient industrial zone uncovered in Luxor's Valley of the Monkeys, which I had never heard of before. The Egyptian Ministry of Antiquities has announced new archaeological discoveries in Luxor, highlighted by a remarkable industrial zone in which workers manufactured items for royal tombs. Egyptian archaeologist Zahi Hawass, who headed the excavations, made the announcement on Thursday at a press conference in Luxor, reports Aram Online. Khaled El Anan, Egypt's antiquities minister, along with Mustafa Wazir, the Secretary General of the Supreme Council of Antiquities, attended Thursday's press briefing. The discoveries were made in the West Valley, commonly known as the Valley of the Monkeys, and in the East Valley, also known as the Valley of the Kings, the final resting place of Tutankhamun. Excavations in West Valley, which started back in 2017, have yielded an ancient Egyptian industrial zone in which funerary ornaments were produced on a mass scale. It's the first of its kind ever to be found in the area. Each workshop had a different purpose, Hawass told CNN. Some were used to make pottery, others to produce gold artifacts, and still others to manufacture furniture. Now, the pictures of the site they're excavating from are unremarkable. Those of you who have seen Raiders of the Lost Ark, if you remember the sequence where they're taking the Ark up on the island and Indy's up there on the hill with the Panzer Shrek. missile, or RPG, which didn't exist at the time, by the way. It's a little anachronism in the film, amongst many. But anyways, the road they're traveling around, that's kind of what this looks like. There's some squares cut into it where they're digging around. But the artifacts that they have pictures of are pretty interesting. They have, it's like this triangular shape, hunk of rock that obviously was intended to be something else, and for whatever reason, the rock was broken up, and you only get the little triangular piece of it that has the Eye of Horus on it. There's some jewelry and some beads and other things like that, and there's this one thing that they look like the pins you use to extract the SIM card on your smartphone. That's what they look like. They're a little thicker than that, they're made out of different colored stones, which I don't know what they could have been. But that's it is really neat. And they also found a shallow depression in the rocks, which they believe was essentially a cistern where the workers would get their water from. And I don't know, the article doesn't specify how much other details they got out of it. So I don't know if any of this is referenced in those documents they found, which detailed the building of the Great Pyramids that I talked about on a previous episode, where they had all the documents proved that there was no slave labor involved with the building of the Great Pyramids of Egypt. The fact that, they detail how much the workers were paid. They have the records of, the housing allotments that they gave to the workers, the medical treatments they gave to the workers, all this stuff. So the whole thing in the Bible about the Jews being slaves, doing all that shit, bullshit. Not that you didn't already know that, once again, we have more proof that it's bullshit. And like I said, I don't know if this is tied into that or not. I wouldn't be surprised if it wasn't, however, because I'm sure that the documents that they uncovered would have made references which would have told them about some things like this. And, they would have certainly started digging around for it. Of course, Egypt is one of those places where you probably can't turn up something ancient, when you dig. I mean, I'm sure every time you turn over a shovel, there's some, oh shit, that's from the 4th dynasty. it's like supposedly in England, you can't dig more than a couple inches without hitting something the Romans threw out. I don't know if that's true or not, but it's always a funny story. For, those of us in America who, we rarely dig up anything anymore. Of course, there were all kinds of artifacts here and that the Native Americans built, but we destroyed them when we found out that they were built by the ancestors of the Native Americans and not white people. Because we're racist as fuck.
Whoever controls the high ground of space will control the world. The Roman Empire controlled the world because it could build roads. Later, the British Empire was dominant because it had ships. In the air stage, we were powerful because we had the airplane. Now, the communists have established a foothold in outer space. Pretty soon, they have damn space platforms up there to drop nuclear bombs on us, like rocks from a highway overpass. Now, how in the hell did they ever get ahead of us?
From space.com. Cosmic mudball meteorite smells like Brussels sprouts, finds new home at museum. It looks like a block of mud and smells, some say, like pungent vegetables. Nonetheless, the latest addition to the collection at the Field Museum of Natural History in Chicago is a wondrous thing. A visitor from across the cosmos that fell to Earth earlier this year as a meteorite. This piece of the so-called cosmic mudball meteorite, dubbed Agaszacharis for the region of Costa Rica where it landed, weighs about 4 pounds. Unlike many rocky or metallic meteorites, it has a distinctive aroma that that is somewhat like that of cooked Brussels sprouts, Field Museum representative said in a statement. This odor comes from organic compounds such as amino acids. Billions of years ago, malodorous meteorites like this were likely what seeded Earth with the building blocks for life. And Field Museum scientists will study the smelly space rock for clues about the materials that shaped our solar system, according to the statement. Sadly, the article doesn't talk about, you know, what the estimated age of the meteorite is or where it might have come from. I believe we found one or two meteorites which date from around the start of the solar system. I don't think we found anything which had to have come from somewhere outside of the solar system. I may be wrong on that. But I don't think we found anything that predates the solar system or came from somewhere else in the universe. But it would be interesting to see where this, you know, if they knew where this came from, because sometimes they can figure out that, you know, they, thanks to the wonders of mathematics, they can sit there and they can say, well, it hit at this angle in this place on Earth, so it had to have come from this part of space, and, you know, that means it was from here, and they can work out a lot of orbital mechanics and get an idea where it originated from, whether, you know, it was something that was cast off by a Trojan asteroid which passed close to the Earth, or if it was from some other asteroid. But there's no indication that they've done that or been able to do that in this article. That would be really interesting to know. As for the rock itself, well, it honestly, if you've they have them all over the South. I don't know about other parts of the country, but in the South we have a lot of these fences that are stone, and they're, you know, they're made out of carved blocks, and they're not smooth like a wall, but they're, you know, they're, the rocks have been shaped to be flat on the top and the bottom so they can stack on one another, and that's what this looks like, except for it's sort of a weird, very dark green, sort of like the dark green that you'd see on military, like ammo boxes and things like that, where it's just barely discernible that it's green. That's what it looks like. And unfortunately, they don't say what amino acids were found in it. It may be that they haven't had a time to do a full analysis of it, but it would be really interesting to know. Somebody put forth this idea, which is unlikely, well, not necessarily unlikely, but they pointed out that, you know, astronauts, when they're in space, they, you know, they, their shit gets ejected into space. And in theory, since, you know, there's all kinds of bacteria and stuff in there, if it drifted to another solar system and landed on a planet, it would, you know, be the birth, you know, the starting point of life on that particular world. And, you know, I mean, it would explain a lot of things if we had, in fact, evolved from shit. But nobody, of course, has proven anything like that. And none, so far as I know, none of the fecal matter that the astronauts have ejected could have even headed away from the Earth at this point. It's all in Earth orbit or on an orbit between the Earth and the Moon. Since for the bulk of the Apollo missions, if not all of them, I think, well, after 13, they stopped doing the free return. Anyways, on the first few Apollo missions, they did what was known as a free return, which meant that even if the rocket didn't fire, the capsule and everything, command module would swing around the moon and head straight back to Earth. And it would require an effort for them to put the thing into orbit around the moon. And they changed that in after 13 or on 13. So that, you know, in order to get the astronauts at different landing spots. So it's actually possible, depending on when the astronauts dump their shit overboard, that it could be flying out of the cosmos, and in billions of years it could end up, you know, on some other world creating life. I mean, that's, you know, probably the heat death of the universe would happen before then, but you never know. Anyways, you know, just like we shit all over everything here on Earth, we're shitting all over everything in space, because we humans are like that.
Tea, Earl Grey, hot.
Really need to find a new bumper for this segment. From 3DPrintingIndustry.com, HRL Laboratories places high-strength aluminum in the hands of 3D printers. In September 2017, an HRL Laboratories team published a paper announcing that they had succeeded in 3D printing a traditionally non-weldable high-strength aluminum alloy. A feat of ingenuity, the team functionalized an incredibly crack-prone material with an average yield strength up to 580 millipascals, or megapascals, I guess. 2 years later, the material used by HRL in this experiment became the first additive manufacturing aluminum alloy registered with the Historic Aluminum Association, or as the Brits say, aluminium. Association. Known as aluminum 7A77.60L, this metal powder for 3D printing is now available to buy directly from HRL. By commercially releasing the material to the market, HRL has now achieved what it set out to do. HRL's goal in developing materials has always been to make sure designers have the opportunity to use the highest performing materials possible, explains Hunter Martin, PhD, chief metallurgist at HRL Laboratories. I know this doesn't sound like a big deal to a lot of you, but if you are familiar with welding, you have an idea of why this is so important. Welders will tell you that aluminum can be a bitch to weld. In fact, in my lifetime, I can remember when people would basically just throw their hands up at welding anything that was made out of aluminum. They always said, it's not, you know, you're better off just getting a new part rather than welding it because it's so hard to weld aluminum. So for them to be able to do 3D printing with an aluminum powder is a pretty big deal. And this is like what I talked about on the bonus episode with the metal powder in zero gravity, where they're using a laser to weld the stuff together. It's if you remember all that, this would be a similar process. Another, so you would have something that, as the laser hit it, it slowly sinks down into the material, and you get a, you know. And then when the part's finished, you have to shake it out of all the powder that's in there. But this is a huge deal, especially the 7 series aluminum alloy. That's the stuff they make the really important aircraft out of. And the company that did this is co-owned by General Motors and Boeing. This is important because they can start using this to make things for aircraft and cars, which will make them lighter. The parts will be simpler in terms of, well, you know, you'll have a complex assembly, but it's all made at the same time. And the guy on the assembly line just bolts it in rather than having some guy put it together and then handing it to the guy on the assembly line who bolts it in. And it also offers possibilities because since they can 3D print a part, they can design parts in ways they wouldn't do normally if they were casting it or forging it or machining it out of metal. So it'll lead to some exotic shapes. Probably won't necessarily see them because they'll all be tucked up underneath the car. But this could lead to 3D printed cars made out of metal. As you well know, aluminum is very light. It's not as strong as steel, although 7 series alloys are really, really strong. They're pretty close to titanium in strength, and titanium is a little heavier than aluminum, but it is stronger than steel, so they really like using that for aircraft. But that is actually easier to weld than aluminum is. And this article is, you know, basically it's a glorified press release. And it doesn't mention that if they do it in an inert gas atmosphere or if they can do it in an ordinary atmosphere. And if you're wondering what an inert gas atmosphere is, they take a gas like argon or neon or something that doesn't tend to react with the material and just flood the area that it's being worked on, welded in, so that it displaces the oxygen and prevents the oxygen from bonding with the metal when it's being welded. I think that's what made aluminum so hard to weld, was that it tended to bond readily with oxygen. Aluminum, until the late 19th century, was called the metal of kings because it was so hard to extract out of ore. Now, of course, it's simple as fuck. One thing that I'll be really interested to see if they attempt to do with this is if they start making engine blocks out of the alloy. I don't know if they use 7 series aluminum for engine blocks or not. I think they use it for transmission housings, but I could be wrong. I know they make some of them out of aluminum, which can cause a problem for reasons I won't get into, how I know all that. But anyways, one of the things that it was one of the big innovations at Saturn when GM started that division up was they pioneered what's known as lost foam casting. What they did was they took styrofoam and made a part for like the engine out of it, buried it in sand, and then poured molten aluminum in a hole, which melted the foam, and the aluminum replaced the foam, and they got the part. They did this because they could make more complicated castings than they could with other methods. I've experimented with that a little bit, but I don't like it because foam is a pretty nasty pollutant, and you can't really, I certainly can't do anything about the air pollution generated by that. Presumably GM could. But anyways, it was heralded by them because it made for lighter engines. They could cast the blocks in fewer parts by doing it that way. Presumably, if this or some of the other aluminum alloys that the article goes on to mention they're working on are suitable for engine blocks, then they'll start doing that, which has tremendous potential because you can have a significantly lighter engine block. Just randomly, I happened to be thinking about something earlier today before I saw this article. Back in the late 40s, just after World War II, there was a car company called Crosley. You may have seen like Crosley radios or refrigerators or a few other appliances, same company. Anyways, after World War II, Crosley had this idea, and unfortunately their idea was a little ahead of the technology of the era. But what they were doing for a couple of years, they had what were called Cobra engines. And that stood for copper brazed engine. And they were stamping the engine blocks out of sheet metal and then brazing slash welding them together to make the actual engine block rather than casting it out of steel. And the reason they were doing this was because the, you know, the blocks were significantly lighter than they would be if they were used, if they did cast metal. It doesn't sound like a lot when you hear that, well, it saved 30 pounds, but when you realize Crossleys were very tiny cars with little four-cylinder engines, and 30 pounds was about half the weight of the engine, that's actually significant. So I would think that this would allow them to do, you know, significantly lighter weight engines. Granted, of course, internal combustion engines are on their way out, but this might enable them to start, you know, for the final decade or so that internal combustion engines are the dominant mode of propulsion in cars. This might allow them to make significantly lighter engines. Whether or not they'll do that, I don't know. I don't know if that even occurred to them to think about this. To give you an idea how well this system could work, if it can be used for engines, if they can get the finished product to be highly polished, then you could have an engine where components that now are separate, some of the shafts and gears and things like that, those would actually be made inside the engine. Granted, that would mean that, you know, when those things broke, the engine had to be thrown out because there'd be no way to get to them. But considering those things tend not to break until the engine has crossed like a couple of million miles, who cares, right? Right. But you blinded me with silence. She blinded me with silence. From Gizmodo.com, how the last woolly mammoths met their demise on a remote Arctic island. The last mammoths to stomp on Earth lived on Wrangel Island in the Arctic Ocean. This isolated population lived for thousands of years after most mammoths were gone, but when extinction finally came, it happened quickly. New evidence may finally explain what happened to these stubborn holdouts. Research published in Quaternary Science Reviews is shedding new light on the last population of woolly mammoths and the possible reasons for their extinction. Chemical analysis suggests the mammoth's habitat on Wrangel Island was in decent shape when they finally disappeared some 4,000 years ago, and was therefore an unlikely reason for their extinction. Rather, the new research led by Laura Arp from the University of Helsinki suggests prolonged isolation on the island made the mammoths genetically weak, making them vulnerable to extreme weather. Other factors like poor access to fresh water and human predation were cited as other possible reasons for their demise. Now, I was a little taken aback by this story because I had read a couple of years ago or more that, you know, it was genetics that had determined what wiped out the mammoths, finally, on this little island. And I want to remind everybody that these mammoths were still on this island walking around while the Egyptians were building the fucking pyramids. Okay? So, this was, you know, these aren't guys who were hanging out with Thad, who was throwing spears. These were guys, you know, and wearing, you know, bear skins and for clothes and stuff like that. These were guys who were around when what we think of as the beginnings of human civilization were well established. So, anyways, the article goes into some detail about the whole genetic issue, because, like I said, I had thought that, we'd established that, you know, they had been inbred for so long that they developed genetic weaknesses and they died. What this new study shows is that the final die-off of these mammoths was rapid. So there were a few thousand on the island at one point, and then, like, something happened and they were all gone. And the belief is that there was some kind of weather event, which they do not know what it was as of yet, that did them in. One of the things that it might have been is that it's a condition called rain on snow, where you've got snow on the ground, then it rains, and the rain freezes on top of the snow, and the animals can't get to the grass and stuff they need to eat. That's trapped under the snow. Happens all the time in the world, and, you know, doesn't necessarily mean an extinction event or necessarily things are really bad. I know in certain parts of the country where the snow gets really deep and things like this happen, you can see, you know, in the summertime, you look at a tree and the bark is bare way up, and that's because, you know, that's the part of the tree the deers and rabbits could get to when it was snow on the ground to have something to eat. So it may have been something like that. And apparently these mammoths were not as adept at storing fat for the winter as some other mammoths. So that would explain why they went out. But the big reveal really in this is that it was a sudden event. It wasn't they just, you know, gradually dropped in population. You know, I think at one point the island was supposed to have had, like, at its peak was like 4,000 mammoths. And then, you know, it's so it wasn't like, well, they went from 4,000 down to, you know, just one that was wandering around. No, they went from 4,000 down to, say, maybe 100 or something like that, and then something bad happened and wiped them all out. Or maybe even they were so genetically weak that 4,000 could have been on the island and could have been wiped out by, you know, rain on ice or some kind of similar event. There's no signs that humans were involved in their extinction on this particular island. The earliest human earliest evidence we have of humans on the island is hundreds of years after the mammoths went extinct. So we didn't kill them off there. Everywhere else we pretty much did, but there, no, they died on their own. And some of them may have been wiped out, or maybe it was the mastodons, I don't remember. Anyway, some of them they think got wiped out because a meteorite or something exploded, or a comet exploded in the Earth's atmosphere and killed a bunch. Whether directly, because they found, like, fossilized tusks with particles embedded in them that had to have come from a meteorite or a comet, or, you know, from, you know, they changed the atmospheric conditions and things like that.
There is no loyalty except loyalty to the party. There is no love except love of Big Brother. All competing pleasures we will destroy.
From thehill.com, and this is the tip, basically, of what I've teased about in the opening sting. Tlaib says Democrats have discussed detaining White House officials who don't testify. Representative Rashida Tlaib, Democrat of Michigan, revealed in a new interview that House Democrats have discussed jailing allies of the president who do not comply with congressional subpoenas, an escalation of the House's efforts to enforce White House compliance with an impeachment inquiry. Tlaib told Deadline Detroit that such an action, known as inherent contempt, would be, quote, uncharted territory, unquote, for Congress, but added that, quote, serious conversations, unquote, about taking the step have occurred within the Democratic caucus. There have been actual serious conversations about what the logistics would look like if we did have to force someone through a court order to come before the congressional committee, she said. This is pretty uncharted territory for many of us and even for Congress. Tlaib's comments echoed those of Representative John Garamendi, Democrat of California, who called for the House to do as much in a CNN interview earlier this week. This is the story that you haven't heard a lot about because everybody's talking about the horrors that we've unleashed upon the Kurds, which, if we have time, I will get to that. Not to minimize what's happened there, but this issue right here is what democracy in the United States is hinging on. And I don't think most people realize it. You know, if you've been paying attention at all to the news, you know that there's multiple impeachment inquiries in the House because our president is a corrupt fuckstick. And Congress has issued a number of subpoenas to various people in the Trump administration, and the Trump administration has said, fuck you, we're not going to honor them. This, well, not that so much, but how Congress handles those issues determines the fate of America. And this is true whether or not we impeach Trump without the requested stuff that's been subpoenaed, because what Trump is doing is he's defying congressional authority. When the Founding Fathers set up the government, all three branches were supposed to be equal in power. You know, checks and balances and all that. Unfortunately, over the years, we've tended to cede power to one branch or the other. It shifts from time to time. There was a period of time where Congress tended to dominate, and now we're in a period of time where the executive branch tends to dominate. If Speaker Pelosi does not say, we have to hold these people who are rejecting our subpoenas or refusing to abide by them accountable, then we're at risk of the destruction of this country. Even if they get Trump out, even if the Republicans fall out of power. Because what happens, and what has happened, or is happening right now, I should say, is, you know, Nixon did certain things when he was being investigated, and now that Trump's being investigated, he's pulling from Nixon's playbook because he knows what Nixon got away with. Well, Trump doesn't know, but his lawyers know what Nixon got away with, and they're trying to pull that shit again. Nixon didn't defy subpoenas. Trump is. Even if Trump gets impeached, if the people who defied the subpoenas are not prosecuted for defying the subpoenas, then we're guaranteed that in the very near future, maybe not with the next administration, but certainly an administration within 20 years, will say, well, Congress is subpoenaing us, fuck them. I don't have to respond to it. That will be bad. Because we've set the precedent that Congress isn't going to do anything if you defy their subpoenas. And it will be that much harder when it happens again, which it will, if Congress doesn't do something now. If they do something now, there's a precedent set that says you can't get away with this shit. But if they don't, if they say, well, we got him already on all this other stuff, we don't need this documentation, so it doesn't matter that they defied us, the next jackass who's a corrupt bastard in the White House will pull the same thing. And it will be harder for whomever, I mean, ideally, we'd like to think that the Democrats will remain the party of law and order and justice and all that shit, but let's be realistic here. Every party becomes corrupt after a period of time. Whichever party's in Congress will have a harder time subpoenaing or, you know, prosecuting people who defy their subpoenas because it's not done this time. And I do not know, which bothers me, I do not know if Speaker Pelosi will say, no, we're going to enforce this, we're going to enforce it hard. If she does, that would be the best thing, because it would reassert Congress's power as a co-equal branch of the federal government, and it would tell anybody else who's a corrupt bastard in the White House, you're not going to be able to get away with that. You're going to have to figure out something else. But everybody is just talking about the Turkish situation and the Kurds, which is terrible, I admit. But, you know, our society is hinging on this moment in time with this issue. If Speaker Pelosi doesn't act to see that people are held accountable for not obeying congressional subpoenas, then, you know, it's going to be bad. Because not only will you have somebody who's in the executive branch say, well, fuck it, I don't have to respond to a congressional subpoena. You'll have members of, you know, corporations and individual citizens who say, well, nothing happened when the Trump guys did it, so why the fuck should I have to worry about this shit? And, you know, if that Congress decides, well, no, we're not going to let this shit happen, and they start enforcing it there, it's all going to be drug out. Well, you know, you guys, you had that big, huge, critical moment with Trump, and you said he did all these bad things, and yet you didn't enforce the subpoenas now. Then, are you saying this shit now was worse than what Trump was doing? I don't think it is. It may be bad, but I don't think it's as bad as what Trump was doing. So, this is what you have to pay attention to. If they enforce the subpoenas, we're all right. If they don't, we're in big trouble. So, by all means, please put pressure on your members of Congress, though your representatives in the House, and tell them that these subpoenas must be enforced, that there must be consequences. And even if your representative, like mine, is a Republican, you need to point out that, hey, sooner or later, the Democrats will try to pull this shit, and you don't want that to happen now, do you? But it's got to be stopped. Or, you know, that's when, you know, the next time it happens, that's when we will collapse as a democracy, which, you know, may be sooner than any of us think. A couple other things before I get out of here. One is, if you've not been paying any attention, Elizabeth Warren is in a bit of a war with Facebook. She's upset, understandably so, because Facebook has decided that they're going to adopt the policy that they don't care if a political ad is false or not, they're going to run with it. You know, they're going to let people run it. She's pointedly, you know, going after this by running what she has, you know, makes no qualms about admitting are fake ads that say Zuckerberg has endorsed Donald Trump for president. That's not true, exactly. I mean, he essentially has, because Trump's, you know, runs a lot of false political ads. And so, you know, effectively, he's endorsing Trump by allowing false political ads to run on his platform. Never mind that broadcast networks and cable networks are pulling those fake ads that Trump tries to run, or, you know, not running them at all because, well, they have some ethics. Zuckerberg does not. And if you need any further proof of that, I'll have a link in the show notes to an article that talks about how Facebook, oh gosh, I don't know, a couple years ago or so, said, oh, we're making this big push into video and everybody's gonna love it. And, you know, so they started telling all these people, oh, hey, look, you know, your Facebook video is getting millions of views. So you really need to, you know, switch your operation over to Facebook rather than putting it on YouTube where, you know, you're only getting a few hundred thousand views. Well, it turns out that Facebook was lying about how many views the videos were getting on Facebook. Not really surprising considering, you know, I don't know about you, but I rarely watch videos on Facebook. Most of the time, if there's a video on Facebook, I just scroll past it. I'm not there to watch a fucking video. I'm there to see what my friends are posting or what's going on in the various groups I'm in, when Facebook actually lets me see the content that's being posted in those groups and not what it thinks I want to see. But that's another story. And the fine that Facebook is getting for lying to these people and, you know, basically destroying some companies because they moved everything over to the Facebook model since they were told they're getting millions more views than they were on YouTube, and it turned out that they weren't, so they're now bankrupt. Facebook is getting a $40 million fine. Facebook makes billions of dollars in profits, so they don't even notice a $40 million fine. That's fucking, you know, the change rumbling around in Zuckerberg's couch. So, you know, Elizabeth Warren, who, you know, I absolutely love, and for a variety of reasons, is very heavily going after the Facebook and a lot of the tech companies and saying they need to be broken up. And this kind of proves her point. Whether or not she'll be able to do that if she wins, who knows? But it is definitely something to pay attention to because Facebook has demonstrated that they can influence the outcome of an election as far back as 2012. They did quote-unquote experiments where they showed more people, you know, you post I voted on Facebook. Well, in areas where they showed more people those posts of somebody saying I voted, more people turned out in those elections. In the areas where they didn't show that, fewer people turned out. Well, if you want to influence the outcome of an election, all you've got to do is say, well, I want candidate A to win, not candidate B. Candidate A supporters are most likely in this part of town or this part of the country. Candidate B's supporters are most likely in this part of town or this part of the country. So candidate A will get more, you know, those people that in the area that support candidate A will see more posts of people saying, I voted, I voted, I voted, while those in the areas inclined to support candidate B will see fewer of those I voted posts, thereby suppressing the turnout in a close election. That is enough to flip it. And, you know, we get, because of the Electoral College, a close election can be flipped pretty easily. It happened in 2016, if not in other elections. So it is definitely something to be concerned about. All right, I'm going to get out of here because it's getting late and I got to edit this thing and get it together. Show notes will be up sometime later on this week. I don't know when, because I don't know when I'll be working. If I get off at a sane amount of time tomorrow, then they will be up tomorrow. If I don't get up in a sane amount of time, or I don't get off, you know, if I put in a 12-hour day tomorrow, then, you know, they'll be up on the first day that I don't put in a 12-hour day. Oh, God damn it, and I fucking forgot again. God damn, thanks everybody who supports the show on Patreon. I meant to put that at the beginning and I forgot, and it's too late to redo it. Sorry, guys. Anyways, I'll see you next week.
That's it for this episode of the Atheist in the Trailer Park podcast. You can subscribe to the show on iTunes, Stitcher, as well as just about anywhere else podcasts can be found. Many of the episodes are also on YouTube. Follow the show on Twitter. At TeaParkAtheist is the show's Twitter handle. It's on Facebook at facebook.com/trailerparkatheist.com. If you happen to like the podcast, please rate it on iTunes. If you'd like to support the podcast, there's a donate button on the show notes page. You can support it via Patreon at patreon.com/TN Tucker. Thanks for listening.
Say goodnight, Fuzznuts.
All I know is this violates every canon of respectable broadcasting.
Damned cat.